Welcome to our community garden where the sun is always shining and the birds are always singing and I, Jesse, am always talking about growing in humility. Humility is putting others first by giving up what you think you deserve. I'm just curious, have any of you shown humility to people in your life this month, or have you seen someone else show humility and put others first? Those are great examples of humility in action. I absolutely love hearing that. You know, when you show humility to others, it's a great way to treat others the way you want to be treated. You see, the truth is, we all need God's help to grow in humility. Our humility can grow and grow like a tiny seed grows into a plant or flower. Some seeds are really tiny, and some are even smaller than you'd expect, but they grow into huge plants that produce amazing flowers and veggies. I am so glad that God can help us grow in all kinds of ways, including humility. We'll discover another important part of humility in our Bible story today. So over this past year, we've been looking at God's big story and seeing how everything leads to Jesus. We talked about Jesus's life on earth, how he always showed love and compassion and taught people about God and healed people who were sick. Jesus died on the cross for our sins, and then he came back to life. That's what we celebrated on Easter a couple of weeks ago, and that is where we're picking it up today. So let's worship together and then jump in.
Hey everybody, I'm Lawson, and look at what I just found in the pantry. Triple stuffed fudgeroos! Mine, all mine! Don't mind if I do. Anyways, in between cookies, I have a great story for you today. It's from this kid, Randall, who lives down the street. Now, Randall has been waiting months for the release of the Playbox Pro 7. And the whole time, he's worked extra hard earning money to buy it. No chore is too small or too hazardous. He's washed the dog and everything else. Randall's even packed lunches for his dad to take to work. Chef-worthy lunches. Randall saved all the money he's earned. So much money! Now he's got just enough for the Playbox. But when Randall goes to grab the Playbox picture off the fridge, he spots a new photo of Miriam. Now Randall's family sponsors Miriam so she can go to school and have enough to eat. And Randall realizes, hey, her birthday is next month. And Randall asks his dad, will Miriam get any presents? And Dad says, not unless we send money for a gift. Randall stares at the play box and imagines how awesome it will be. Totally out of this world. Randall's worked so hard and he totally deserves it. But then he thinks what it would be like to have a birthday without one single present. And Randall asks his dad if he can send money for Miriam to get some presents. And Dad says, sure, that's a great idea. Randall gives Dad some of the money he's earned, and together, they send the money for Miriam's birthday. Then, Randall and Dad sing happy birthday to Miriam.
Happy birthday to you.
And even though Randall is a little sad he can't buy his Playbox right away, he knows that making Miriam's birthday happy was totally worth it. So kids, always remember this, that humility is putting others first by giving up what you think you deserve. Hey Mom, do you want any of these?
Ooh, I thought you'd never ask.
Perfect, we'll share this one.
Thank you.
Hey RPK. Our basic truth today is I should treat others the way I want to be treated. That's right. Now, that means that we're supposed to love others the way that Jesus loved us. So why don't we sing Love Like You? Come on, get on your feet. Let's do it. Nice job, you guys. Okay, our bottom line today is this. Put others first by helping them understand. Now, a couple weeks ago, we celebrated Easter, and we sang this song, We Believe. There's no moves to it. I just want you to stand there, sing it out, and declare that you believe that He is who He said that He is. Let's sing it.
Desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear,
there's only one foundation.
There is only one foundation. We believe, we believe.
And in this broken generation,
in this broken generation, when all is dark, you help us see. Well, there is only one salvation.
believe.
And we're not afraid to say it.
We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, that He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe.
So
let our faith be more than anthems,
more than the songs we sing,
greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations, we believe.
Today, we believe. We believe when we open your word and we read what it says, we believe everything that it says. We believe that you love us, that you care for us, that you sent your son to this earth to die for us and then rise again and pay the price for every single one of us. God, what an amazing thing. Thank you that you have given us people around us to help us understand who you are and what you've done for us, and help us to be able to humbly help others understand who you are and what you've done through our words, through our actions, through the way that we love them. Thank you again for your amazing love. In your name we pray today. Amen.
Hey there, welcome to Story Lab. This week we're talking about humility while we take a look at the story of two guys on a road trip who had the greatest surprise of their lives. Ooh, spicy.
Hey, I'm Carter.
And I'm Zeke.
We're talking about humility, which is putting others first by giving up what you think you deserve.
You know what I've always thought I deserved?
What?
An invisibility cloak.
What would you do with the invisibility cloak?
I am so glad you asked. Wrapped in a secret sheath of invisibility, there's nothing I couldn't do, like acquire extra cookies. Or surprise my friends. The possibilities are endless.
Okay, number one, I can see why you want to be invisible for karaoke.
Oh, I don't want to make people jealous of my amazing vocal stylings, obviously.
And number two, you will be happy to know that scientists are working on a real invisibility cloak.
What?
Yep, scientists have engineered a new class of materials called metamaterials that interact with light in ways we've never seen before.
A metamaterial cloaking device can hide an object by reflecting light around it. So, someone watching will simply see signals from images behind the object, as if it weren't there.
A real life invisibility cloak? Mind blown.
Zeke, what are you doing?
Ordering my invisibility cloak, of course.
I hate to tell you this, Zeke, but...
I-N-V-I-S-I-B-I... Why are there so many I's?
So far, scientists have only been able to cloak something less than 1 inch tall.
Oh. So I need a invisibility cloak and a shrink ray.
Actually, I know a way we can make something disappear right here in this room.
I've already been disappointed once today.
No, really, it's super easy.
Don't break my heart.
This will work, honest.
Well, then,
let's make it. For this experiment, you need a large beaker, a small beaker, and some oil. Step one, fill a large glass beaker about 3/4 of the way with oil. Step two, take the small glass beaker and using tongs, push it all the way down into the oil. There you go.
Whoa, it really worked. I can't see the small beaker at all.
It's our very own cloaking device.
Okay, science, how does this happen?
When light travels through glass and then the oil, the speed of light slows down. On reflection, this makes the glass look invisible. The slowing down process of light and reflection through certain objects is known as the index of refraction.
The beaker really is in there, right?
Yeah.
I love science.
Well, we're about to look at something else that wasn't what it appeared to be.
It's time for...
The story before the story.
Today, we're in Luke, the third book in the New Testament. Luke is one of the four Gospels, the books that tell the story of Jesus' life. But before Luke, in the very beginning, out of a deep, deep love, God made an amazing world.
But when people turned away from God, the world was broken. God made a plan to draw people back into relationship. So at the right time, God's very own son, Jesus, came to live among us.
When Jesus grew up, he traveled from town to town, teaching and healing.
But the religious leaders made plans to get rid of him. Jesus was crucified on a cross and died.
But early Sunday morning, Jesus returned to life. Lots of his friends saw him.
Which is where our story starts.
Take it away.
Hey everyone, I'm Brian. On the very first Easter Sunday, things were a little wild and crazy for Jesus' followers. First, the tomb was empty. Then, some reported seeing angels. And finally, some said they saw Jesus alive. For those who had not yet seen Jesus with their own eyes, it seemed too good to believe. One of these followers was a man named Cleopas. Sunday afternoon, Cleopas and a friend were walking from Jerusalem to the town of Emmaus, about 7 miles away. Luke, who wrote down this story, didn't tell us the name of the friend, so let's give him a name. How about, Micah. As they walked, Cleopas and Micah talked about everything that had happened in the last week, trying to understand. While they were deep in conversation, a man came up and started walking along with them. Spoiler alert, the man was Jesus. But God kept Cleopas and Micah from recognizing him. Jesus asked them, "What are you talking about as you walk along?" The two men stopped in their tracks. They just couldn't believe anybody could have missed all the action.
"Are you the only person visiting Jerusalem who doesn't know about the things that have happened there in the last few days?"
"What things?"
"About Jesus of Nazareth."
He was a prophet. He was powerful in what he said and did in the sight of God and all the people.
The chief priests and our rulers handed Jesus over to be sentenced to death. They nailed him to a cross. We had hoped that he was the one who was going to set Israel free.
Yeah. Now it's 3 days since all this happened, and some of the women who followed Jesus have told us something crazy.
Get this. Early this morning, they went to the tomb, but they didn't find his body. They came and told us they saw angels who said Jesus was alive.
After that, some of our friends went to the tomb. They saw it was empty, just as the women had said.
How long it takes you to believe all that the prophets said? Didn't the Messiah have to suffer these things and then receive his glory? As they walked together toward Emmaus, Jesus started explaining everything that the scriptures said about him. Now remember, these men did not have the New Testament. They had the laws that God had given to Moses and all the stories and prophecy written down in the Old Testament. Jesus went through it all, step by step, and explained God's plan. He told them how it was predicted all through scripture that the Messiah, Jesus, would come to save God's people, and that he would have to die and return to life. Cleopas and Micah were completely floored by what Jesus said. When they reached Emmaus, it looked like Jesus was about to keep going, but they didn't want the conversation to end.
Stay with us.
It's evening. The day is almost over.
So Jesus went into the place where they were staying and sat down to dinner with them. He picked up the bread.
Thank you for giving us our daily bread.
As Jesus broke the loaf of bread and handed it to Cleopas and Micah, their eyes were opened. Suddenly, they recognized who he was.
Jesus,
it's you.
As soon as the men recognized Jesus, he disappeared.
Remember how excited we were on the road as he explained what the scriptures meant?
It could only have been Jesus.
The men were so excited that they left their dinner sitting on the table and ran all the way back to Jerusalem that evening, 7 whole miles. They went immediately to the place where Jesus' closest friends were staying.
We've seen Jesus.
He walked with us on the road to Emmaus.
The men told about everything that had happened. It was just one more amazing confirmation of the incredible truth. Yeah, that Jesus is alive. The end.
Just imagine if you're one of those guys. I mean, you find out it's Jesus, and then he just disappears. Like, he can do that now.
I wish I could have heard Jesus himself explaining God's whole plan.
Yeah, that was a pretty awesome thing Jesus did for them.
So, what's our part in the story?
Jesus cared about his friends so much that he wanted them to understand the big picture of what God was doing. And we can take the time to help others understand what God is up to as well.
Like, if you have a friend that feels like they don't fit in anywhere, remind them that God has made them unique, and he has a special place for them to feel that no one else can.
Or maybe your cousin is going through a really rough time. You can encourage them that God can use even really hard things to do something good.
You can show humility by taking the time to help people understand other stuff too, like a hard math problem.
Or how to tie their shoe.
Or the best way to shoot a basketball.
Yeah, just be patient, even if they don't get it the first time.
Or the second time.
Yeah, I mean, I sure don't understand things right away either.
Yeah, that's right, me included. See you next time.
So, here's the thing. Put others first by helping them understand.
Could we get a giant glass vat of oil for me to turn invisible in?
Ew.
The oil and glass invisibility effect does not work on opaque objects such as humans.
Well, rats.
How about you just enjoy some karaoke music? Thanks for joining us in the Story Lab.
See you next time. Fly me to the moon. Let me play among the stars.
This story really shows how much Jesus cares about people like the two men who were walking to Emmaus. As the men walked along the road, they must have felt so confused and scared. They knew Jesus had died on the cross. They heard rumors that Jesus might be alive, but how could they be certain? And they had no idea what might happen next. Jesus wanted the men to understand that They didn't have to be afraid or worried. This was all part of God's plan. Of course, the men knew that they needed to make sure that everyone heard and everyone understood that Jesus was alive. When we help others understand, that's a great way that we can show humility. And that's what we need to remember today. It's our bottom line. Put others first by helping them understand. I bet that you can think of someone who's helped you understand something important like God. Like maybe someone in your family or a friend, your small group leader at church. It takes a lot of humility to do that, to be there for someone when they have questions or just to show them what it means to follow God with the way we treat them. We can encourage people who are feeling down. We can remind them that God loves them and made them unique and special. We can put them first by showing them how valuable they are. Our memory verse for this month is such a great reminder of what it means to show humility. These are Paul's words from Philippians 2:3. Don't do anything only to get ahead. Don't do it because you are proud. Instead, be humble. Value others more than yourselves. Let's say it together. Don't do anything only to get ahead. Don't do it because you are proud. Instead, be humble. Value others more than yourselves. Philippians 2:3. We can put others first by helping them understand that God loves them and that Jesus is alive. Let's pray about it together. Dear God, thank you so much for the story of these two men on the road to Emmaus who knew that they could trust in you. Thank you for revealing yourself to us and to them and to through your word. We pray that we are able to have humility like Jesus and like these men as we go about our week. And it's in your name we pray, amen. I just love how our verse this month tells us to value others more than yourselves. We can do that by helping people understand what is true. And something I know is true, this plant looks amazing. Do you see how this is growing? This is too cool. I got it. Do you see this?